if it focuses on the top three. So this kind of goes down to like choosing your audience as well. For example, you know, let's say like, I'll give you a personal example. So like my parents are obviously like immigrants when they first came to Canada. And like, have you guys like had parents that like, you know, won't do anything for themselves and they're just like, oh, like I need to earn money. I have to like, you know, do X, Y, Z for the family. That's because like they don't feel the sense of kind of fulfillment in the bottom two categories. So they're not even willing to explore any of the factors up here that might lead to intrinsic motivation. It's very, very sad. So treat your parents well when you become a designer and make lots of money. Lost my train of thought here. That's kind of sad. Does that make sense to you guys? I don't know if I'm rambling here a little bit. Cool. So let me talk about examples of intrinsic and extrinsic motivation done well. Wealth Simple, for US folks here, that's basically like Betterment or Wealthfront. It's like a robo-advising platform. This is an example of how they use extrinsic motivation. For example, $50 bonus when they open and fund a new Wealth Simple account. That's a very strong extrinsic motivation. It's money, it's positive reinforcement. It works for Wealth Simple for multiple reasons. One, a Wealth Simple user doesn't need sustained long-term motivation or intrinsic motivation to be a good customer for Wealth Simple. Ideally, they sign up once and then they just leave it and never touch it again. That's actually ideal for them. So that's why they've actually optimized their kind of offering here for extrinsic motivation to increase it really, really high at the beginning just to get them to do that one core task. And then afterwards, it doesn't really matter. Does that make sense? And then using Duolingo as an example here, they don't do a great job at this. That's why I put the little asterisks, but I couldn't think of another example off the top of my head. But they do use some forms of intrinsic motivation. I actually think they ruined their entire motivational model because they're pressured to make money. And that's why they have the whole microtransactions now with the gems and the streaks and the streak freezes. So ideally, like when you remember like OG, oh shit, we only have 5 minutes left. Okay, I actually have a lot of content left. I can give you guys two options. I can blast through this really quickly, but I'm totally cool staying like another 20 minutes and going through in more detail. What do you guys think? I'm cool staying, Esther, if that's cool with you.
Yeah, that's totally awesome. Thank you so much.
Yeah, no worries. I'm glad you guys are liking this, by the way. I wasn't sure if this topic would be like too boring or too abstract, but it seems like it's resonating with a few guys here, which is awesome. All right, so on the topic of intrinsic motivation and products, right now, the main thing that they're trying to facilitate is intrinsically is the feeling of competency when you master a language or pass through a certain level of courses. They have a social aspect of belongingness because you know you can see your friends and their progress. And they have a certain factor of autonomy in the sense that you can choose whatever language you want to learn and whatever order you want. So they actually, foundationally, they have a good intrinsic motivation model. But as I mentioned before, they kind of ruined it because they've shifted it towards extrinsic motivation, which I think was like a really bad strategic decision to make money. Or maybe they ran out of like, you know, cash flow, not sure. But they've added all these additional elements here, like buying gems to, I don't even know what gems are for, but they have streak freezes, which like doesn't really mean anything. They're like, you buy this thing and then, you know, somehow your streak gets saved. So that's actually an example of, that's a very good example of the over-justification effect, which is like a huge, huge, huge pitfall that you want to avoid when designing a motivational model for your product. What this means is when somebody is intrinsically motivated to perform an action or do a task, and you start giving them an extrinsic reward, as soon as you remove the extrinsic reward, they lose their intrinsic motivation completely. A really famous example or case study of this was they took two groups of students that really like to draw. Like they intrinsically love drawing. It was like a hobby. They did it in their free time. Group one was the control. They just had them come into the lab and draw every week. Group two, they came into the lab, and then for every picture they drew, they gave them a lollipop. And then after, I think, like a month, for group two, they stopped giving them lollipops, and they realized that all the students didn't want to draw anymore because they were so used to getting a reward for something that they previously didn't need a reward for. They kind of permanently kind of lost their intrinsic motivation at that point. So very kind of sad, yeah. So Duolingo also fucked this up a little bit because originally they were very intrinsically motivated, but once they added all the extrinsic motivations and, you know, like they added like streaks and stuff, once they lost that streak, people didn't really want to continue learning because they're like, you know, like, what's the point, right? Like, I don't have the same kind of fulfillment and motivation I had before. So believe it or not, this is actually the legitimate term for this. It's called the what the hell effect. And this is very common in dieting where, let's say you're doing really good, you're on a diet, and then you accidentally mess up and you eat a cupcake. You're more likely to break your diet even further and get like fries and like, you know, ice cream afterwards because you're like, what the hell, I already broke my streak or I already broke my diet. Whereas like if you had stayed like true and strong at the beginning, you wouldn't have been as likely to break it once kind of tempted with that possibility. And same thing here with Duolingo. I know so many people just go on Twitter and type in like Duolingo streak loss or something. And you'll see a lot of people with like, you know, 300-day, 400-day streaks completely giving up on Duolingo because they broke their streak one time. So, you know, that's kind of the cautionary tale here of, you know, not polluting your experience with extrinsic motivations if you've already built a really strong intrinsic motivation model. Prompts. All right, we're almost done. 15 more minutes-ish. I have a bonus kind of section too if you guys are interested, but we'll see how we go. So prompts, this is essentially going to be related to the routine aspect. And as a lot of people might have guessed, I'm going to be talking about the hook model. The hook model is essentially how you build habit-forming technologies, and it's split into four quadrants of trigger, action, variable reward, and investment. And the trigger is what we're thinking about in terms of the prompt. Essentially, it's split into two categories, internal and external. External prompts are notifications and emails, essentially, like very, very literal examples. It's a sound or a big flashy notification that pops up. Internal is more like the feeling that, oh, I should do something. Like I should, you know, Duolingo as an example. External is like, oh, like, don't miss your streak, like do your 5-minute lesson today and get it as like a push notification. Internal trigger would be like, oh, like I have 5 minutes, I want to learn more Spanish on Duolingo. Do you guys kind of see the difference? So external is useful at the beginning, but eventually there's like some stat for this, but like if you're external triggers and prompts don't work within the first week, they basically will never work anymore. So you have a very limited window to kind of capture their attention and build their habit and shift the trigger to internal, which, you know, you can't silence an internal trigger, but you can always silence an external trigger, which is what I always say. Does that make sense? Thumb up. Cool. All right, let's call it action. So action is basically what we focused on this entire time. It's, action works when you have the prompt, which is the first section here, intersecting with the appropriate levels of motivation and action. So that's everything we just talked about. That's the action piece of the hook model. Whoops. Variable reward is the interesting factor here. So this is kind of the motivating factor. When you perform an action, right before you get the reward, you get this huge hit of dopamine. A lot of people think that dopamine is actually associated with the reward itself. But if you look at studies and any scientific paper on this matter, all the dopamine actually hits when you anticipate the reward, and the anticipation is much sweeter and the dopamine hit is much higher when it's variable, meaning you're not sure what you're gonna get. The very classic kind of study here with mice is when they kind of set up this like cage and this like lever that dispenses food, the control was, you know, mouse presses lever once, they get one food pellet and it's a 1-to-1 ratio. Whereas the experiment control, the actual experiment was once they pressed the lever, they had a chance to get a pellet, so a food. And even though the first scenario, the rat got more pellets overall and like a better overall reward, because the reward was expected, their motivation wasn't super high. The dopamine wasn't like super concentrated, and they just like pressed it enough times to get the food they needed. Whereas in the second experiment, the rats, because of the variable reward, they kept pressing the lever until they passed out from exhaustion. And if you think about video games, for example, it's much more interesting when you get like a rare drop or a unique item than if that item was guaranteed to drop from a boss monster. Or on social media, for example, when you get a notification, you might get like a huge dopamine hit because like, oh, it might be that person that I really want to message me, or it might be a really exciting job opportunity when you get an email, because there's like a chance of it being like a disproportionately high reward rather than like a expected reward. And that difference is kind of what drives these habit forming behaviors, because they're more likely to want to continuously engage in those actions, because there's always gonna be that chance or possibility of a really, really good reward. And yes, from Ari, this is also why intrinsic motivation leads to long-term product and service usage, because if they're intrinsically motivated, ideally through a intrinsic variable reward, that's kind of like the intersection sweet spot. It's very hard to design for, but if you can get it right, like you'll have like the most engaging product on earth, and very few products get it right. Social media in the past like decade has done really well at this, almost too well. If you've looked at like the recent news and that Netflix documentary, I forgot the name of, but like their engagement loop is so intense that like, you know, as soon as you get a notification, you get that like rush of like, oh, like it could be, you know, like a really exciting call. Like, it could be from my crush, or it could be from an employer, or it could be this like opportunity. That's going to give you the rush to like have high motivation to check. And every time you hear the notification or the external trigger of the social media app, you're going to associate it with that dopamine hit. And then that dopamine will kind of push you to complete that action. And even without external prompts, you know, like if somebody's like addicted to their phone, when they feel bored, they're just going to seek out sources of dopamine. And historically, their brain has been hardwired to associate the dopamine variable reward with that social media app. So it's like, oh, I have 5 minutes, I'm gonna check Facebook, or, oh, like I'm bored, I'm gonna check Instagram and see if there's any notifications. That's kind of how they built that habit forming technology. And then from Megan, for sure, anticipation of new content is absolutely the variable reward. It's intrinsic motivation too, because it's like a kind of evil form of intrinsic motivation, but it definitely is still part of intrinsic motivation. And then the next part here is investment, is essentially how do these rewards get better over time? So essentially, if you want to create a really, really strong habit forming loop, every action the user does on the app should increase the intensity or volume of their reward over time. And that's known as investment. For example, the more you use Instagram, the more followers you have, the more connections and friends you have on the platform, every additional session, every additional pass through this loop is gonna increase the intensity of that reward. And that's also why just concepts like sunk cost fallacy and switching costs. This is why people tend to not love switching products. Like, even if a new product is a little bit better, they're very unlikely to switch because of the investment factor. And the rewards they get from using your product is already so high that the new product quite literally needs to be 10x better. Like, even 2 or 3x better isn't enough. It has to be 10x better to actually have a chance at converting existing customers into, you know, the new platform. And then kind of like bringing it all together, like, if you go through this model enough times and you have every quadrant structured and designed really well, eventually you'll create the state of internal triggers, which is, you know, it starts off as, you know, I should do this, but eventually it'll become, I want to do this. And then that becomes true intrinsic motivation. You build a very healthy and sustainable and engaging app over time. Sorry, my throat's kind of drying out. That's why I feel like I've kind of chopped up a bit. But does this model make sense to you guys with the examples? Cool. Let's talk about one last thing and then we can do questions. Let me talk about gamification at a very, very high level. This is almost entirely focused on variable reward scheduling. So a lot of people don't use gamification properly because they kind of misinterpret what it actually is. A lot of people think of gamification as taking game elements and applying it to your product. So like badges and leaderboards. When you do this, it doesn't really work because it's not tied to any core action. And the user has no incentive to earn those like virtual rewards, which is what people most often add into their product. So to actually use gamification the right way, it's about using game design principles and creating something called a core loop inside your app, which is also very much related to the hook model. So this is like another interpretation of the hook model, but essentially you have the action going to the reward, going to expansion, and then to investment. It's basically the same thing. It's just like a different kind of a parallel based off the game design industry, but a very classic RPG example. The action is to fight monsters. The reward is to get item drops and the experience. And then the anticipation, as I mentioned, is where the dopamine hits. And then you have the expansion, which is related to investment. Like, how do you get better from this action? How does that improve your experience? If you fight a lot of monsters, you get a lot of experience, a lot of drops, you get access to more parts of the game and you have a better experience over time. And that's kind of how it's structured here. So how this looks like in an actual product is user engages or performs an action. The product offers a desired reward. A less desirable reward. It's like an incremental reward. They continue to engage the action via the hook model, and then they start to build anticipation of eventually getting the desired reward. A lot of the times, humans have this bias of kind of like luck and chance. So like they think like the lottery players, for example, like they think like, oh, like I've lost 100 times, 101 time. Oh my God, my grammar. On the 101st time playing, I have no idea. After playing it for a long time, they think that they have a higher chance of actually winning the lottery, but it's like not true. There's an equal chance every single time, but it's that kind of like sunken cost and investment fallacy that drives them forward. So if you do create a really good experience, if you can subtly influence in a way that, you know, after they engage with the action a lot of times, either through investment or something else, they should have a higher chance of getting their actually highly desired reward after a period of time. And eventually, if you can ladder that incrementally, then you have a much, much higher chance of them becoming very loyal to your product. And through this entire process, it's called a reinforced conditioning loop. And then one last concept here is loops can be of different sizes, and basically they have different time scales. So for example, on Instagram, let's say, checking photos, very short loop that they can do in 30 seconds or less, posting a new photo on Instagram or going on IG Live or creating an IG Reel, that's a much longer loop that takes, you know, potentially a couple of days, an hour or 2 hours or even a week. If you want to create a really engaging product, you need a good combination of short loops, which are called inner loops, and also outer loops, which kind of have a higher payoff over time, but might take longer. A associated concept here is called time to value. And it's a really crucial part in hooking users in at the beginning. If it takes a long time for users to get value out of your product, then they're very unlikely to stay for that entire duration. That's why you need to create a lot of mini inner loops to provide some incremental value and incremental dopamine hits to kind of start building that habit early on. And then once they've, engaged with your product for a long enough time, then they have a chance of actually completing an outer loop and getting the real value from your product. I think that's my last slide. Oh, last slide here is Bumble, for example. If you look at their notifications, it's very, very well done in the sense, because look at the phrasing here. 7 likes and any one of them could become amazing. If they told you, or they're like, hey, here's a photo of the person that I just swiped on you, that wouldn't be as exciting because the reward isn't variable anymore. But because they phrase it like this, you have the anticipation that the reward can be like exponentially good. So you have a high kind of drive to check the notification go into the app. Going back into the whole loop model here, Bumble is definitely a good app because it kind of builds on the investment over time. Like the more you swipe, the higher likelihood you have at getting the major rewards and getting the kind of like ultimate goal of like finding like, I guess, someone to date on a dating app. So it's really well structured in this sense. Sorry, I've lost my trail of thought, but this is my last slide. Sorry if the last piece wasn't super clear. I actually wrote an article that explains it a lot better, but I didn't want to go into too much detail. So I'll link it to you guys afterwards. If you guys want to hear more from me or like follow me, I have all my links on beacons.ai/richard.ux. You can also find it on Instagram. My handle is richard.ux. In my description, there's a link to everything. I run a private Facebook mentoring group where I just post like a lot of content, and I have a group session like this every Friday at 4 p.m. There's one tomorrow. Feel free to join the group if you want the link, if you want to RSVP. I also do a crap ton of writing, a lot of guides, and like very, very detailed articles on what I think people don't explain very well on the internet. So I try and fill that gap. I have a newsletter and a blog, and also do mentoring consulting if you guys are interested. Here's some links, I'll leave it up. But, oh, thank you, Esther. I'm happy to take any questions you guys have in the meantime. If you guys want to unmute or to type anything in.
Hi, I was wondering if you have any personal examples of any of your projects where they fell short in one of the areas of the hook or anything you talked about and what you did to improve it?
Let me think. So with like designing motivational models, like if you keep these frameworks in mind, you can't really go wrong. The only time you go really off base is if you don't truly understand your user as well as you think they do, or you make a lot of assumptions. For example, like a big factor here is looking at the action loop. If you follow good design principles for interaction design, you can't really mess up the ability piece, because you can always make incremental improvements and do usability testing over time to make sure that your product is easy to use. The easiest part to mess up is actually the motivation part, because if you don't understand what their goals are and what the motivations are and what they actually want to accomplish, you might design a loop that's like not appealing to them at all. And in those situations, you kind of have to go back into the drawing board and either reevaluate your product market fit or do more research to understand your core user segment, or maybe there's like sub segments that you didn't even realize and you need to design like specialized loops for all of them. For example, can't think of any from my own work, but the really famous story of Instagram when it first started, it was called Bourbon. Their core value prop focused entirely on check-in, which is really popular at the time. But once they've kind of like refined and really understood their core audience and their motivations, they realized people were getting their variety, the majority of their value from the photo filters and the ability to share their photos socially. So they ended up creating a loop entirely focused on that and scrapping all the unnecessary features. And through that, they were able to create one of the most engaging apps of all time. Does that answer your question, Jenna?
Yeah, thank you so much.
Cool. Reading the written questions, but I will prioritize questions that people unmute their mic for. I think I answered that. From Ari, does button shape, circle, or square have an effect on Fitt's law? There is no ideal button shape unless you make it like super weird. Like the size of the button will basically, the shape of the button shouldn't influence the hitbox. So even if you have a button with rounded corners, if they kind of hover their mouse or click on the little, cutout where the rounded corner overlaps the square, they should still be able to click it. The kind of key distinction or the key factor for button shape is actually branding. Typically, if you want to go for like a very professional or serious or kind of legit or techie kind of vibe, you want to do square corners or very, very small corner radiuses, like 2 pixels. If you want to go for something that's much more friendly and vibrant, you can go fully rounded. But generally, no big implications on Fitt's law. A question from Fred. At what point are these types of research impactful in the thick of time constraint? So very high level is, as a designer, you should be constantly collecting different mental models, heuristics, frameworks, principles, and kind of concepts because they help you make decisions faster. When you're working on a project, the time constraint usually isn't in the execution. Nowadays, with most power tools like Figma, Auto Layout, all that stuff, creating a UI is very fast, simple, and easy. The majority of the difficulty comes in decision-making. So with decision-making, we're always making decisions with incomplete information, and we use data and research to make better decisions, essentially. Understanding a lot of frameworks and heuristics will minimize a risk of you making a faulty decision, and also minimize or reduce the times where you actually need to do research if you have the relevant kind of model or heuristic to follow. And that lets you move faster. So generally, like, it's always a good idea to absorb as much of this type of stuff as possible and figure out how to apply in your work, because that saves the most time. A lot of the times people will do research for the sake of doing research, especially if you're like a bootcamp graduate, they really push research for some reason. Not saying research is bad, but research has to have a purpose. If you don't change any decision or it doesn't help you make a better decision through research, you probably shouldn't do it. Does that answer your question, Fred? Cool. So Dorothy's question. So for Miller's law, like, I just want to kind of introduce a concept for working memory and the idea that the human brain has like some degree of RAM. So you shouldn't try and overload them with too much information they need to keep in their working memory at one given time. The thing that was disproved is the exact number of items people can hold, which is 7 ± 2. That number is actually going to be much higher or lower depending on like a lot of different factors, like their attention, their age, their culture. So it's basically saying that like there is no magic number anymore, but just understand and appreciate the concept of the working memory and try and keep that mental interaction cost as low as possible. Does that make sense, Dorothy?
Yeah, thank you.
Cool. All right, I think that's everything from the chat. Top three UX books. Okay, I have a hot take here where I think books, courses, and resources are going to be subjective to everyone and also should not be consumed in its entirety. A lot of people will be like, hey, like, what's the best UX book? And then they'll force themselves to read something that, you know, might not be interesting or relevant to them. When I first started design, everyone recommended Design of Everyday Things to me. I think it is quite literally the most boring book I've ever like come across in my entire life. I could not get through more than 10 pages. So like, it wasn't relevant to me, but like I've like absorbed bits and pieces of what that book explains over time as it becomes relevant to my work. So the best resource, whether it be book, talk, newsletter, whatever format you did, it's going to be subjective to how you learn and also what you're currently doing. If you're not working on something in which that piece of knowledge is relevant and useful, don't waste your time trying to consume it or learn it, because it's not going to make sense to you. And you're gonna hate it, and you're not gonna enjoy it, and you're not gonna retain it. Every single time I force myself to like, oh, like do this chapter in this book, read this book, finish this online course, I've literally retained close to 0% of it. But now after I've adapted my learning style, I think I retain like 99% of everything I learn, because I only take the pieces that are relevant and then I apply it immediately to my work. And then through that, it kind of locks it in. So yeah, TLDR, yeah, there's no right answer. Like, there's no amazing book, because it's going to be subjective, right? And if I tell you, like, this book is really, really good, like, thousands of other designers would have read it. And, like, if you read it too, you're not really going to stand out or be unique or special. The best way to kind of have mastery in design is to really, really have your own niche. And your own niche is going to be kind of driven entirely by your natural curiosity. Like, everyone is naturally curious and interested about something in design. And if you are exceptionally curious and interested about one aspect, you have a very good chance of being the best in the world at solving that type of problem, because you're naturally going to spend more time and effort learning it because you enjoy it. You're never going to beat somebody that finds what you find like hard fun, because they're just going to be doing it like 16 hours a day and they're not going to be expending willpower for it. But like, if you're trying to kind of you know, follow somebody else's path through their learning curriculum like to the T, you're gonna have a really bad time, because they're going to be enjoying it and they're going to be having fun, but you're going to be like constantly working and stressing and kind of using all your willpower to kind of get through that. Overrelated answer, but I hope that helps. Sorry, it was a bit of a cop out. So to Fred's question, yeah, like, so when people teach design, they always emphasize process, which I think is actually a huge, huge, huge disservice, because literally, like, in industry, I don't know a single designer, myself included, that has ever done the same process twice. Every process for every project is gonna be different based off like a variety of factors, the constraints, the skill sets of the people you work with, the industry, the scope, the technology and tools that are available. The knowledge, the age group of your target audience, there's going to be a lot of different tools. So don't focus on the tools and the methods. Think about being adaptable and think about like, what is it that you're actually trying to learn or do, and like what decisions you need to make to create the best product. Like, I will literally like learn new tools and research methods like on the fly as I need them, because they always change so often. Like, every couple of years, a new UX research startup pops up and makes something that was really, really hard to do a few years ago really, really easy. For example, Optimal Workshop makes tree testing into like a 20-minute task, whereas before it used to take me 2 weeks to do. And I don't know where I was going with that example, but the TLDR is that, like, don't try and feel like you have to master a list of tools. Like, it really doesn't work like that. If you really had to, like, come up with a list, there's maybe only like 4 or 5 that are actually, like, really commonly used. It's usability testing, concept testing, card sorting, tree testing, surveys and questionnaires and interviews. That's basically all you need for 99% of all use cases. And even most cases, you won't use all of these. You'd only use some of these. Like, I've only had to card sort once in my life, and I've done like probably over 100 projects because it was just like never relevant at the time, right? So don't focus on the methods, focus on the research questions. And it's more important that you ask the right research questions at the right time, and then figure out the tool or buy the software to do it, than to try and like prepare like a mental library of tools. Yeah, I'll repeat the, sorry, I said 4, but I realized I listed 6. So it's usability testing, which everyone knows, concept testing, which is the precursor to usability testing. It's showing a concept and asking people what they think of it and would they use it and what they think it does. There's card sorting and tree testing, which is for validating information architecture. And then there's questionnaire surveys and interviews, which is used for generative research to understand your user ahead of time. Okay, so I'm gonna repeat that one more time. Evaluative methods for testing design, concept testing and usability testing. Information architecture validation, tree testing and card sorting, generative user research, questionnaire surveys and interviews. Did you guys get that? Cool. Any other questions? Hey man, I'm glad you guys enjoyed this. I was trying really hard to make it so that it's like not something that you can like read in a book or just Google. Hopefully you guys have like an appreciation for, you know, psychology and interaction design, and you think about your product experiences a little bit deeper. I can send out the slides. I'll send the slides out to the organizer and then they can send it to you guys through email or something. Where was I? Yeah, one more piece. Like, everything I've taught you, this is within the realm of a sub-discipline of design called growth design, which is really to optimize for business metrics over time, which is, you know, revenue generated, cost reduced, users acquired, and users retained. And all of these are kind of like different strategies I often use to drive those 4 business metrics. If you want to make a lot of money as a designer, look into growth design. It's like one of the kind of like booming fields right now that a lot of companies are starting to hire for. And once you're able to kind of frame your design more intentionally in the context of how you drive the 4 core metrics related to business value, you're able to get a lot more leverage in negotiations and positioning yourself as a designer that stands out in the market. Cool. So I'm gonna give it maybe 2 more minutes for questions. If not, we can wrap up. If you guys want, please follow, or you don't have to follow me actually, because I don't really post on Instagram anymore, but go to my Instagram, click on this link, join the Facebook mentoring group and the newsletter. Those are the 2 things that I use the most right now. If you want to be super nice, send me some feedback through like an Instagram DM. Just tell me what you thought about the session, what you liked, what you didn't like. I know my voice is monotone, so I'm working on that, but any other feedback, please send it through. Would be super helpful in making my future talks better. I do have a YouTube channel. I actually, I do have a YouTube channel. I record most of my past talks. They're not edited, And they're also like pretty bad because I'm recording on my potato webcam. But you can see a lot of my past talks on similar, not similar topics, but topics of this level of depth and interest on my YouTube channel. You can find the link on my Beacons website as well. So my specific niche in design that I'm very curious about comes from a background in biomechanics and pre-med. I've always been really interested in data and psychology, and I realized that it uniquely positioned myself to be really good at optimizing numbers for companies and products. So I've always been really interested in using psychology and data to drive metrics that businesses really care about. And that's kind of how I ended up in growth design. But then I also do focus a lot on 0 to 100 consumer startups because I also really like visual design. And I just ended up being really, really fast at designing new concepts and prototypes, which tends to be like a very kind of sought after skill within that discipline. So I won't talk too much about career positioning and niches, but I do have a talk that I just uploaded this week on positioning yourself as a designer to be really, really attractive and high leverage and high earning within the current modern day job market. If you're curious about that stuff, go check it out on YouTube. And yes, as Esther says, please fill out the form for this workshop. Yeah, she's got it covered. Cool. Any other questions? If not, we can end here. Esther, I don't know if you want to say any final words
for your audience. Just really quickly, I think you did a great job wrapping up. Thank you so much for taking this extra time to go through all these concepts super thoroughly. Again, if you join the call late and you missed a couple of the concepts in the front, no worries. All that information will be shared with you. But beyond that, Richard is a great resource and he's listed a lot of these on this slide. So be sure to check those out. I'm sure it'll be really helpful for you and your journey as you go through design. And last but not least, if you didn't already know, this workshop was a part of a series that leads up to our Designathon, which starts tomorrow. We have a couple more spots left open. So if you haven't applied yet, I highly encourage you to do so. You can also find that at the website I've posted, which is sbcreativelab.com. But with that, that's all we had for today. So thank you for sticking through, y'all, and have a great rest of your day.
Thank you, guys.